Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome our next speaker, Mr. Ajay Bakshi, Director HR, Vodafone India Services Private Limited.
I would like to call upon Professor Parmanandan sir, Director of Finance, to welcome Mr. Ajay Bakshi with a bouquet.
Thank you, sir. May we now call upon Ms. Neha Rathore, Student Manager, Balaji Institute of Telecom and Management, to introduce Mr. Ajay Bakshi, sir.
A very good afternoon to one and all present here. I have the privilege of introducing our guest speaker for this session, Mr. Ajay Bakshi. Mr. Ajay Bakshi is Director Human Resources at Vodafone India Service Private Limited. Sir has over 2 decades of experience in human resources and sales management. As head HR for Vodafone Shared Services, Ajay sir is managing 10,500 plus employees spanning across Pune, Ahmedabad, Bangalore and Chennai. Sir has held leadership positions at Cholamandalam MS General Insurance Corporations Limited, Prudential Process Management Services, Arvind Limited and Sterlite Technologies Limited. Ajay sir is an alumni of Manipal Institute of Technology and University of Pune. Sir, now I request you to please enlighten us with your words of wisdom. The dice is all yours, sir. Thank you.
No, I don't. I think this is fine. So good evening, everyone. It's nice to see the hall being full and absolutely with an energy-packed audience. So what I'm going to talk about over the next half an hour here is what I call as 7 mantras for success. Success which probably all of us have joined a management institute for a particular reason here. All of us want to be successful. I presume. Could I have hands up? Who wants to be successful? Excellent. So 100% want to be successful. Now the key question is, what do we define success, or how do we define success? Because success could have different meanings here. I obviously will not pass a mic around, but I'll just ask you a few questions to really understand what is your definition of success. How many of us associate success with a title? A designation. Can I have your hands up, please? Like a managing director, vice president, a director, or whatever. Okay. Good. How many of us associate success with wealth or money or luxuries, a BMW car, a Mercedes car, or whatever? So I see more hands here. Interesting. How many of us relate success with creating value or doing something different? Okay, that's truly a good show of hands. And that ultimately is what success is all about. The rest are nothing but byproducts of success. So if you create value, you do things differently, you are bound to be successful. You are bound to gain money, you are bound to gain designations, you are bound to gain fame and recognition here. That will all happen by itself. So when I talk about success here, now success is something which is very, very subjective. And it is you who define your success parameters. What is success to me could be very different from what success means to you or anybody else. And there is nothing wrong or right about it. We are the owners of creating our own success, which includes creating our own definition for success. So for those of us who associate success with wealth, okay, fine. That is your parameter. Those of us who associate success with a designation or a job title, that's your parameter. Those of us who associate success with value, definitely it's a larger and an overarching goal. I'll share an example here. All of us have heard of Apple, I presume. All of us know one of the core founders here, Steve Jobs. So Steve Jobs, when he started off, he started off in a small garage, and for him the definition of success was to drive transformation and change in what they do. His core goal in life was not to earn wealth or not to become the largest company in the world. It was to do to drive innovation and to drive success. So when he was hiring one of his top executives who worked in one of the multinational cola companies here, I obviously will not take names here, he was trying to get this person on board for a very long time. And he tried to convince him, why should he join a company? And Apple at that time was a very small company. Was not even a $1 million enterprise here. So he wanted to get him on board. So he was telling him that, see, you can continue selling cola the rest of your life. You can make millions of dollars there. You can have a fancy job title. But at the end of the day, when you retire and you go back to your grandchildren, what will you tell them? That I've spent the rest of my life just selling cola? Or would you like to join a company where you can transform the world through innovation? And interestingly, this individual joined him there. So again, coming back to the topic of success, it could mean different things to different people. So starting with the first mantra, which I define as the key mantra for success, is having drive, energy and passion. Without drive, energy and passion, your goal will only remain a goal in paper or in thought. If you don't have the energy, don't have the enthusiasm, and you don't have the belief in your goal, nothing will happen here. I'll share a practical example or a personal insight of one individual whom I've personally worked with, who demonstrates a lot of that. This person was a first generation entrepreneur. He started his, he inherited a small family business, a very, very small family business, selling metal scrap in a small city called Patna in Bihar. And he came to Bombay for the first time. He's a 10th class dropout, interestingly. He came to Bombay, and that was the first time he had come to a city. He came to a city where he couldn't speak English. He was enamored by the buildings which he saw. He went to this building called the Oberoi. How many of us have been to Bombay or are from Bombay? Okay, so good number. How many of us have seen the Oberoi there at Nariman Point? So good number here. A very tall, majestic building in Nariman Point, one of the key prime real estate properties in Bombay. He saw this building. He couldn't speak English. The guard there, the darban there or the watchman there, didn't allow him entry. So he said that one day, he couldn't speak English as well. He wasn't attired appropriately. So he says, one day, I will ensure that I can eat a meal in this restaurant. And this individual, and he was a scrap dealer at that time, and he used to sell scrap from this company called Balco, which was a public sector undertaking, Bharat Aluminium Company here. And over a period of time, through his drive, his passion, his visionary oversight, he landed up buying Balco. He landed up buying Hindustan Zinc from the government of India, and he created this empire called Vedanta, which is a $70 billion empire by itself. So leave alone eating a meal in Oberoi, he can probably buy many Oberois over at this point of time. And I had the opportunity to work very closely with him and his brother here, and the kind of enthusiasm, the passion and the belief which he has, and his ability to convert that belief and passion with a very clear goal, is his energy, enthusiasm to really get it done. I think without this, you can never be successful. So this is the first key mantra of success. Having drive, vision and a very, very clear goal, and the passion and enthusiasm to deliver on that goal. The second part which I would say is strategic thinking and proactivity. To be successful, you have to think ahead. Had Steve Jobs not thought ahead, he wouldn't have created an organization called an Apple. So that's also visionary thinking here. The third part which I would call is humility and willingness to learn. So at any stage of career, any years of experience, you haven't necessarily learned it all. The way businesses are changing, the way industries are changing is truly transformational. How many of us have used a pager in our life, or at least heard of the pager? Okay, everyone has heard of the pager here. I think when I started my career, we didn't even have a pager there. So pager wasn't invented at that point of time. A few years into my career, this pager, this new instrument came in there, you know, which was pretty fancy. We thought it's a technical or a technology revolution where you could stay connected with people. A person could carry a small instrument, you know, in their pocket or in their belt or, you know, in a convenient place, and you could reach out to them. You could give them a message at any time. So we thought it was a technology revolution, and you had these companies, you know, who were selling pagers by the dozen. Then came the new revolution called the mobile phones. And the mobile phones completely made the pagers redundant. So technology does make certain businesses completely redundant here, in this case. Companies who succeed, all of us have heard of this company called Kodak. Clearly, you know, there is this book written by Tom Peters. Has anyone read this, In Search of Excellence? Which had a research from some of America's global companies here. And Kodak was ranked as one of the most successful brands and company at that time. Everyone would have heard of the Kodak camera. But today, mobile phones have completely replaced the Kodak camera there. So it's not competition which has destroyed Kodak, but it is a new technology which has destroyed Kodak. So when we look at it, technology is something, not only technology, but newer businesses, which will now change the way things are working here. Take your concept of cabs here. How many of us have used an Ola or an Uber here? I think virtually everybody. So what happens is, for those of us who used to employ drivers here, we are finding it very difficult to get drivers here. Because all of them who can either get a car or take a loan to get a car would rather work with an Ola or an Uber and earn more than 2 to 3 times the amount which they were earning as a driver, as a salaried driver here. So you see, the way of doing business is completely transforming, completely changing here. The landscape is absolutely very different. So if you don't have the humility and the willingness to keep learning and unlearning all the time, you will be replaced either by technology or by a startup or by an entrepreneur or by a completely new business here. So that's the key mantra of success. The fourth one is resilience. I think no business comes easy and nothing is really glamorous in the world, and you'll have success right from the day one. Success, as all of us have heard of the term, and is 99% perspiration and 1% inspiration. So it's all about hard work and resilience and not giving up when the odds are difficult. I don't think anyone needs an introduction about a brand called Amitabh Bachchan. But Amitabh Bachchan, if you look at his entire career, success didn't come to him on a platter. His first trial and tribunal with, I wouldn't call it failure, but difficulties was, he was actually working, he was rejected in the radio. He applied for an All India Radio job. He was rejected because his voice was a little too heavy and hard. So he wasn't getting a job there. And it's later on that his voice made him, was one of the attributes which made him a star of what he is. He came down to Bombay. In Bombay, he had a big struggle. He came from a very well-reputed family. His father was a famous author, well-known, respected author, as well as a very respected family in Allahabad. Came down to Bombay as a struggler. Found it extremely difficult there. Used to stay as a paying guest in some small-time hotel there. Was struggling to make ends meet there. And there was a point of time where he was thinking of giving up and just going back. At that point of time, I think he was resilient, he was persistent, and the right movie came at the right time. He did a few other movies and roles before that. Zanjeer was not his first film. Saath Hindustani was his first film. But what gave him success and recognition was Zanjeer. You had Prakash Mehra, who identified a tall, lanky guy with a deep, powerful voice. He wasn't sure whether this guy will be successful. The movie was launched and then the rest is history. So that's one part of it. He didn't give up when the odds were difficult. Did exceedingly well. He went into politics, didn't do well there. He was an MP. He defeated this gentleman, I don't know if anyone of you all would have heard, this gentleman called Bahuguna, who was a very established politician in his own right. Amitabh Bachchan displaced him and actually ended his political career. He didn't succeed in politics for a variety of reasons. Came back to films. His initial films didn't do particularly well. He floated this company called ABC, Amitabh Bachchan Corporation. He hired a big shot CEO from Coke to head his enterprise. The enterprise didn't do well at all. Certain wrong business decisions, probably wasn't run efficiently or effectively. Brilliant actor, but didn't necessarily know how to run a business. He made a few hiring decisions which were not probably appropriate or correct at that point of time. His company was on the verge of bankruptcy. His own house was mortgaged at this point of time. Any person would have felt absolutely despaired, having tasted success at its peak, at its zenith here, and suddenly seeing that your company and your own house being mortgaged and almost to the extent of possibly being sold off could have rattled anybody here. But this gentleman, at the age, I think he would have probably been in his 60s at that time. And 60 is no age to go through this. And not too many people can survive it at that age. He was resilient enough, went back to what he did best, that is movies. The KBC show happened, and the rest is history. At the age of about 74 or 75, he still continues to work. ABC has been revived and doing reasonably well is what I understand. So another case in point of resilience here. So whatever you choose to do in life, without resilience, you can never be successful. You will never get success at all times. It's all about sticking to the knitting, sticking to the guns. The other point which I would like to highlight is embrace change and be change ready. I've given examples about technology. I'll also share a very interesting thing which some of us associate where we've seen change really replace ways of working. A simple thing is your inland letters or your post office. Earlier during our time, when I was a student, we didn't have this concept called emails here. So when we had to correspond, we used to write letters home, inland letters here. Or later on when I did my job here, we again didn't have emails there, my first job. And we used to write memos and post it on courier, or we used to fax it across, something which was a little urgent. So this entire thing, faxes, the post office, have now virtually been made redundant through emails, where you can send scanned documents over through emails here. So technology has made things redundant here, and people who haven't embraced change have all been left behind. So the ability, another key mantra for success, is embrace change and be change ready at all times. The sixth one, which I call it, is know when to enter a business and know when to exit. So there is nothing which is permanent here. It's not only about a business, but also employment here. You know, the eras of entry to retirement are all gone. Of course, there are people who retire from companies today, but the population is relatively lesser and smaller. You should know when to enter into a company, or enter, or for those who plan to do entrepreneurial opportunities, when to enter into a business and when to exit a business here. You have to be pragmatic and not emotional about it. A classic case in point is, has anyone heard of this company called Parle? Okay. Has anyone had this drink called Thumbs Up? Okay. So this Thumbs Up was a brand which was promoted by Parle. Something, and Parle at that point of time, when they sold it off to Coke, Thumbs Up had a 60% share of the market here. This gentleman, Ramesh Chauhan, who was heading Parle at that point of time, with a 60% market share, could have been very, very complacent. And with the advent and entry of Coke and Pepsi, which more or less happened at similar time, I think Pepsi came in first and Coke came in second, he could clearly see the future here. And he knew that he can't compete with multinationals in the long run. They've got deep pockets, they've got, it's going to be very difficult to maintain the competitive edge. He sold his brand, and I'm talking about almost, I don't remember exactly, but it's a good two decades back. He sold it to Coke for $40 million at that point of time. And he's reinvested that in other businesses. So he knew when to exit the business, and he wasn't over emotionally attached to that. So the same holds true for your career here. Know when to enter, know when to exit. And the last part here is the seventh mantra, which I would call is taking calculated risks and having a backup plan. Without taking calculated risks, you could continue and you could sail through life. You could do a secure job, you could do a steady job, you could run a steady business here, but there's nothing steady in this world. Has anyone heard of this terminology called VUCA? Okay, so what do you mean by VUCA? Complexity and ambiguity. That defines the business landscape today. I remember when I was doing my MBA, we were taught to make 15-year plans. Today, companies don't even have a 15-month horizon. We don't know what the next 15 months are going to look like. So leave alone 15 years here. You have to be extremely agile. And at this time, you can be proactive as the best you can. But there are times where you'll have to react to the situation. A classic case in point is the Brexit here. No one knew till a few months back that Brexit is going to happen, including people in the UK. It came as a shock, as a surprise to a lot of people here. Brexit is going to impact the economy in Britain, maybe not immediately, and it has already started impacting the economy in India here, especially the IT sector. Infosys, the RBS, has the Royal Bank of Scotland in UK, has decided to shut one particular line of business. And that impacts 3,000 employees of Infosys in this case. So the point which I'm trying to make is there are times where you'll have to take those calculated risks, see things around the corner, make investments, and decide what you need to do, which is right. The world is unpredictable here. Take calculated risks, but more important is have a backup plan. I think where Infosys didn't particularly do well in the spaces, they didn't have a backup plan of redeploying 3,000 people. Now they can't keep 3,000 people on the bench. They'll have to find either a job or make them redundant. So I think in matters like these, as leaders, people have to keep thinking ahead. And don't think, you know, that everything is going to happen only for the best. Hope for the best, but work towards ensuring that things will not happen the way you need to. So always have a backup plan, have a contingency plan in place. It will make you better prepared to handle adversities. So these were some of the key mantras which I thought, which I'll quickly recap for success. One is drive and energy. Second is strategic and proactive thinking. Third is humility and willingness to learn and unlearn. Fourth is resilience. Fifth is embracing change. Learning and unlearning. The sixth is know when to enter and when to exit. And the seventh is take calculated risk and have a backup or a contingency plan. So if you're able to do it consistently, this is something which will give you long-term success. So I'll probably stop here for a while, and I'll also quickly share, because a number of you all given to understand are second year students here. Who will be eventually in a few months' time be applying for jobs. So how many of you all plan to do a job, and how many plan to do a job? I'll ask the second question later here. Okay. A significant, reasonably significant number. How many plan to be entrepreneurs or join their family business? So a relatively fewer number here. So the piece of advice which I would give you is largely for people who are looking at joining a job. What is it that we really look at in students when we hire them? We obviously don't expect them to be completely job ready. That you'll get cracking on the job. And that's the reason you have a training period and a probation period. But some of the things which we look at is, and the things which you need to prepare for, are one is clarity of thought. You know, people will ask you questions, why have you done an MBA? And if your answer is my father has forced me, or my mother has forced me, or my uncle or whoever has forced me, you actually cut a very sorry figure. That may be the true reason, but you actually cut a very sorry figure there. The other thing here is, if you are not clear, if you've chosen a specialization like marketing or finance and you haven't thought it through, that also doesn't help you. People who can give a lot of clarity in terms of their responses and answers are people whom we really think that they've done their homework before they come. The other thing here is when you apply for a company, we do ask people, what do you know about the company? And if you are absolutely blank, you haven't done the homework or research today on the company here, it clearly shows that you are either disengaged or uninterested, or you haven't put in that little bit of extra effort and stretch to do your background and homework. What should you do in terms of your background and homework? One, obviously you should know what the company, what business the company does, how long has the company been there, see the balance sheet of the company, see whether it's a profitable company or not a profitable company, see who are the customers here, see the leadership here, the credibility of the leadership team here, also see what is the market share of the company here and what are the future plans, and more importantly the company's culture. And how much does a company place emphasis on development and growth? That's the other thing which you should be watching out for a company. Another point which I would like to highlight here is when you talk with confidence and talk with conviction. Don't give wishy-washy answers, and don't give answers if you don't have the answer. Be honest enough about it. Tell them, I don't know. Be clear in terms of reasons why would you like to join the company. And you have to be internally clear, and you must communicate the clear reason as well. So join a company which gives you growth, which gives you learning opportunity. That should be a priority. Probably keep money as a secondary or the tertiary goal here. See a strong brand and see the company's credibility in the marketplace. See the company's work culture and then look at money here before you take up a job offer. It's easily to be enticed by money in the early stages and lose out in the later stages of life. But look at learning here. The other thing which you must prepare for the interview is your own subject. They may ask you, some people do ask you, what are your favorite subjects here and how can you apply it? A lot of them will ask you, what have you done in your internship? If you just say, I've done an administrative or a compilation job in the internship, that won't help you score brownie points. People may ask you, what have you done in your internship and what have you learnt? People may ask you questions here, what have you learnt in your MBA curriculum? Be prepared with those answers. It's how well you think through those answers and how well you answer them, I think will really determine whether you stand out from the rest of the pack or you are one of the pack over here. So these are some of the thoughts which I thought I should leave you with. And with that, I'll probably end my session here. And I'll probably throw the floor open for any questions you may have. But before I do that, I would also like to highlight one thing here. I represent a company called Vodafone Shared Services India. We are not, and of course, in the capacity not only of an HR director of the company, but also in the capacity of a board director of the company. I do not represent Vodafone India Limited. So any questions on either Reliance Jio or competition or Vodafone India, I am not authorized to answer that, and I will not be answering that. So anything, if you need, in terms of the topic, about your career, what a company is looking at, I'm more than happy to answer that. So I'll leave the floor open to any questions at this stage. If there are any questions, I'm happy to answer that. Okay, if no questions here, I'll probably end my bit of the session and wish you all the very best in your career. Or do you have a question there? Does anyone have a question? Okay. If not, wish you all the very best in your career. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir, for enlightening us with your words of wisdom. To be proactive, to learn and unlearn, to be resilient, taking risk but having a backup plan were some of the mantras which we learned from this session, which would surely help us in shaping a successful corporate career. We look forward to many more such interactions on and off the campus.
Thank you, sir. May I now request Dr. Archana Srivastav, Director in Charge, BITM, to to present a memento to Mr. Ajay Bakshi, sir.